Morning, everyone. And welcome to another time with Corporate Shepherds. I have the honor and pleasure to also invite and not invite to recognize our distinguished speakers today. I know that things will not be the same when they take the stage, so I just want to at least thank Mrs. Mary Akobome, Executive Director, Heritage Bank. Mary, thank you for coming. And my honorable HR expert and HR Director of Samsung Electronics West Africa, Mr. Kunle Olaifa, is here. And we know that Professor Chris Okwuche is on his way. Well, my name is Heidi. Yours truly, I'm the host, and also I have a mission with Corporate Shepherd, and this is one place for the past going to what, 6 years? We started 2008-09 that we've been taking on seminars and opportunities like this. So those that have always come would have a privilege to talk about it, and if you're coming for the first time, you're welcome. It's not a church service, but it's a place where we rub minds and we have an opportunity to talk about ourselves. I just want to create some opening before I invite our first speaker. And really, the question I've always been asked is, why did we choose to have career excellence as a theme for today? In the last 6 months, I dare say that close to 200 people, I've counted, that's why close to, not 200 exact, but somewhere about 187. And if I add the last week where I had close to 4 or 5 people, mentees of mine, calling me and asking questions or talking about their careers, it's been a hot topic. It's almost as if people are faced with the challenge of A, I want to move, A, I am in trouble where I am, B, I don't think my boss likes me, C, I don't really want to do this, I want to change. What do you think? It's been a mixed bag of what I call different challenges. Now, focus there is to envision that future and then to look at the opportunities. What do you see? Every person, every individual has a different lens on the opportunity. Within what context? That's the C. And what is your understanding of that context? And if you do understand it, there must be a strategy. So essentially, when you see the word focus and the letters focus, F-O-C-U-S, it means more or less projecting something in you that will allow you, you know, start a better way. So this addition is really set towards hoping that a lot of us will walk out of here and have a real look at our career, what we need to do, how we need to go about it. And at the end of the day, checking in to say, am I on the right path? Let me introduce it once again to some that have just come in. Mr. Kunle Olaifa is the HR Director of Samsung. He used to be my... Funny enough, we went in Samsung same time. I left and then he came and then transformed the place. I wish I had the privilege of working with him. Please, a round of applause for me.
Now, I'm trying to get up my slides. I have a few slides just to get us through the discussion. And like I said this morning, it's very much a discussion. When we talk about careers, it's difficult for anyone at any point in time to be a definite authority on it. We all have different perspectives, we have different things to look at, different areas to check and all that. Now, the fortunate thing about it is that the very first question I was going to ask is what's on the screen behind me? What is a career? So, I mean, it's important that we establish what a career is first. Do you agree with me? And then we look at how do we make it excellent. So it's like, hey, what is a mansion? What is a house? What is this? And then we now begin to look at why or what will make this thing better. So it's about us understanding what a career is first. I know there are a couple of, and I like the way what I saw on the screen is, I know there are a couple of different answers, different ways we can look at it. I just want to ask in the room, is anyone who has a different or concise opinion about, hey, this is what I would define a career as. Anybody? What's a career? To my left, to my right? In any way, I mean, whatever destination you give, you define it. You want to try it, man? Okay, great.
Okay, my name is Joy Oyamune, Decision Support Consulting, Range of Marketing Research. For me personally, a career, and I went through everything that was written there, hunting for what I believe is a career. Thank goodness I saw something that is similar to what I did. I believe it is passing through life, making use of your talent in your work life. So that's my definition.
So a couple of words I picked from that. So it's one, life, passing through life, and then using your talent. So it's not just about work. Am I right? Any other additions? Anybody who has something that you feel is included by a career? Anybody? There are a couple of words I want us to pick out as we begin to define career. So one is definitely life. We need to think about the fact that the career is not just about that job. Most of the time, one of the big issues we have in this part of the world is that a lot of people define career. When you mention career, they think of jobs. When people think about career, you start to think of jobs in Nigeria or so on. What's the next job? What's the next salary? Rather, career is a lifetime thing. Career is something that we all have to go through. So the fact that you got your first job and your role was an accountant and the next one is HR, all adds up to be a career, and that's what gives you as a person, that's what makes you better. I tell people, a lot of companies actually miss out on what they can gain from employees by looking at only what the employee has done in the last role. Forgetting that the employee you hire is actually a composition of everything that person has done. How many of us actually do that when we hire people? One of the first exercises I do when I get my team together, when I join any of, when I hire someone, is to download the entire person, question the person, what have you done, where have you done it? Oh, well, I just started to meet, I was in accounting. That your accounting knowledge is important for my HR role. Because the day finance comes to me and they're annoying me, I'll put you in front of them. You know, it happens between HR and finance a lot. Up to 7 p.m. yesterday, I was fighting. They would always have a reason why it is not, and the finance people in the room are laughing, yes. I will fight you. You guys, they always have a reason why the money should not go through. And they never face the employees. It is me that employees will tell, you did not support us in getting this. And I'm the one that will face finance and continue to argue it out. But it's good if I got someone who's got 6 months accounting experience. So because the point is, I can be very, very number dumb. I don't even know what I'm doing. I don't understand it. But this person is good. And it's important for every one of us to begin to look at careers in that way. To begin to understand the place of, hey, this is what a career is. This is why it is important. This is what we will get from it and all of that. As against looking at it as a job. Every day, every step we take there adds up to that career. My very next question definitely will be for us to say, hey, what is excellence? By that, what is career excellence? Anybody in the room? What, I mean, before you came for this session, there might have been thoughts in your mind as to you're coming to listen to Kunle, to Mary, to Professor Beche and all that. What is excellence? What is career excellence? Anybody? I want us to be able to come up with thoughts and ideas around this. Hello? Ma, you want to help us? Okay. The ladies are usually...
Sorry.
I won't use the word smarter now, so that the guys don't come at me.
I would say career excellence has a lot to do with some form of job satisfaction.
The work-life balance. Seems like everything is working out, or everything is working out. How then do we measure if things are working out?
As I said, there's a balance in your work and your life and your life. You actually enjoy the job you're doing, you enjoy the demands it's placing on you. Mm-hmm. Somehow you can balance your life and you can still progress.
Fantastic. I like in particular what she's using, the demand is placing on you. So when we achieve career excellence, it's not necessarily that it's an easy job. It's the fact that it's giving us a challenge that we can surmount. Not that you're getting on the career and then it's an easy one. Many times when people say, hey, I'm doing great at work, it's because they are underworked. Yeah, it's because they are not challenged. The reality is,
just like she said, you're getting the demands, you're getting the challenge, but you're living up to it. You're able to challenge whatever challenge, you're able to prove to everyone that yes, I know what I'm doing. And that is it. Along with the balance. So it's important that when we look at career, because we said it is life, we're not looking at career only with the prism of what I do in the workplace. The successful person in career actually has a total balance.
Now, we're back to work again. So, in a way, career is directly linked to that work fulfillment. So you could have own fulfillment without having career excellence. Is that you? Hello? You don't think so? No, is it possible that you've always wanted to have this number of kids, or you wanted to have a happy home, and then you're not happy at work? How many of us actually check when people receive the money and they are grumpy? How many of us know the number of times that you're actually working with your subordinate's husband, not your subordinate? The mood with which he or she woke up is what you're going to have to battle all day, based on what is stressing that person. It does happen. I mean, we say it every day, right? And this is the reality, and this is why we really need to look at how we look at career and the excellence in itself that we're looking at earlier. Let's go a step further. So we say, which is responsible for your career?
You.
Really? Are you sure?
Yes.
I'm not sure. You are responsible for your career. But what we see around doesn't depict this. Too many people ask and join companies because of career. I hear that every time. Then people sit in front of me at interviews and say, you know, I just want to know what my career will be. And I, the first time you know, I think I was out of point and I was interviewing for a role. And I said to the person, and she was like, there's no career here. I'm like, no, I can't. Career, don't join us. We don't want anyone going to come in to demand a career. But the reality is, you are responsible for your career. But many of us actually live the life of someone else is responsible for my career. Someone else should be telling me what I'll be or what I'll do. What should you expect from your employer? So you are responsible for your career. Are we in agreement with that? I am responsible for my career. And I tell people, I've never heard anyone say, dear children, I'm sorry, because I work first time that I think. It's not possible, you can't blame your employer, but what should you expect from the employer? What should they say? What impact will the employer have on your career?
One demand reduced, one more reduced.
Support? What sort of support? You know, the same support is what your pastor will give you in church. The same support is what your spouse will give you. What do you expect from your employer? What is the impact? What is the impact your employer should play in career excellence?
Opportunities,
okay? Challenging opportunities, right? But sometimes, don't these opportunities also sway us? Challenging opportunities, your career plan, your career projections, since you're the one that's responsible, your employer decides to give you a challenging opportunity by sending you to machinery now. Hello? Nobody seems to be talking anymore. It's challenging enough. So, what you said, your employer should give you a challenging opportunity. We've just called the employer and they're giving you a very challenging opportunity. The chance for you to prove yourself that you can dodge bombs. Right? It depends. So you can prove that all those Udechi that you brought from the East is still working. This is the time. So what should you expect from employers? It's right, challenging opportunities. But I think a couple of ways we can look at that a little more. The reality is, your employer's job, your employer's role is to get from. Nobody cares about your career. That's the reality. I tell people, when you go to insist on seeing job description for a role, and I say, you were hired for that role, you weren't hired for the next role. When you were hired for that role, your job is not to put yourself as more than that role. You were hired for the role. So don't come at me and say, oh, I'm not respected. The role was not respected when you were hired. Don't come here and say, oh, I haven't gotten promotion. The role, the plan was not to promote the role. You were hired for that role. You can turn forward and prove yourself as being bigger than that role. Then the organization will consider you for promotion. But don't turn forward and say, oh, no, I want to. No, you were hired for the role.
The company was very specific when they posted the job on Jobberman. They were very clear when they put it on their website. You were hired for the role. The employer's job is not the career. You can, the point is the employer provides a platform. You can choose to use that challenging opportunity, which is the example of my degree. And so you can be smart and say, yes, I know, it's challenging enough, but I would rather take on other challenges and go to Niger Delta and dodge kidnapping. Make sense? Okay, let's move on. There's another question for us to say. So how do you achieve careers in excellence? What are the things that you think we need to do? What are the steps that we need to take to achieve career excellence?
Hey man, but you said I'm being paid for what I love to do. I have never thought of being any other thing but playing football. I at that time he could not understand why someone was going to pay him for doing what he loves to do, which is also a big part in us getting career excellence. If you're really going to, so Okocha got so excellent in playing football because that was his natural turf. If you throw Okocha into the pool, forget it, forget him and forget the pool and everything there, because his mother, which is also a big part in us getting career excellence. If you're really going to, so Okocha got so excellent in playing football because that was his natural turf. If you throw Okocha into the pool, forget it, forget him and forget the pool and everything there, because his mother. So we say career is an adventure of a lifetime. It's a journey. We shouldn't talk about career and think about it from the point of one job, like you said earlier. It's not just a role. And like every journey requires planning, which is why you're here. And I appreciate everybody that's sitting here, because the point is, if we're talking about our careers and all that, we're talking about a journey. If you're taking a journey from here, for example, to Ibadan, the couple of things you need to do. One is you need to be sure that the car is in top shape. Right?
Yeah.
Two is that you need to fuel the car.
Yes.
If you go with a full tank from here to Ibadan, by the time you're on your way, without reading traffic, you're having to refuel, which is part of what we're doing here. So we've got good cars, we've got a huge tank and all that. But at every point in time, we need to stop. We need to appreciate the ideas of this world who are putting these fuel stations on the road of our careers and say, hey, stop, let's refuel a bit. It's not every time you have to go to ABBA, you have to go to LBS, and but let's come together, let's think, let's have good times, let's be practical about this, and let's fuel ourselves as we go on this journey. So like we said, number one, you need to get a sense of your current state. So someone had said earlier, what are you doing now? If you're really saying, I want excellence, I want to get better, I want to be fantastic, what are you doing now? What is happening in that place where you are now? You know, when people say, what's your current location or state? People think sometimes only of the road. People, you need to think even in terms of geographical and physical location. What is your current state? Part of your current state is also actually examining the current state of where you work. How is your organization, the company you work with, how is it doing in the market? You work with a company that has been declaring loss for 4 quarters. Hello? I say you're excellent. I tell people always, when I talk about job security, and I tell people, if your company doesn't sack you, what if your company is sacked? You are so good, your MD cannot sack you. In fact, the man cannot dream of you. He will sack himself before he sacks you. What if they sack the company? You and the MD will go. Many of us say, so job security actually lies in you. It's about seeing that old view of the current state. Get a sense of where you are going. So we just said earlier, if you're taking a car from here to a battle, it's not if you're taking a car from here on a ride. Because the reality is, the man who is taking the car from here to Ibadan will get to Ibadan before you get to a place if you're going on a ride. Because you will stop at Third Mainland to look at, oh, lovely lagoon. You will see reason to branch off at Bar Beach. And maybe by the time when you're at Bar Beach, the boys will visit you and collect your wallet. Then you start to complain. The man who has a destination, who has a purpose, who knows where he's going, will get to Ibadan before you do get into Lagos Island. That's the reality. A sense of where you're going. An understanding of this is what I want to achieve. This is where I want to be. A plan on how to get there. So there are several ways through which you and I can get to Ibadan. Rail? You don't think it's possible via rail? Even if the railroad will go to Kano first before coming back to Ibadan, which some of us do with our careers, that's the reality. See, you think there's no water between you and Ibadan? You'll be shocked. Or waterways. You can go to Ibadan by foot.
Yes.
What's your plan on how to get to Ibadan? You may decide to go to Ibadan through that same road transport and take your own car. You can get on the express and eat a ride. You can go to public transport. What's your plan on how you want to get to where you're going? You need to make sure your plan is bespoke and specific to you. You can't watch the next man next door and decide on that's the person's plan I'm going to follow. It has to be distinct and specific to you. You know, you can even get to Ibadan through what Oyinbo calls modern technology that we call old technology. You know what I'm talking about? You can call it whatever name. They will call it teleportation. They've forgotten that we finished that technology here. And I was telling people 2 days ago at the session saying, if it was the white man that had that technology, by now, someone said to the teller, by now there will be Egbe Airlines. I said, no. By now there will be Egbe by Dangote. It will be now mass. It will be, so buy 2 shirts of Egbe. This one takes you to London. You know? If it was the white man that had technology, we still. And now, there's actually a lot of research going on teleportation. I was shocked in my head. A lot of big corporations putting money behind it for people to teleport. That's a way for you to get, and I to get to Ibadan. It is the reality. So there could be several ways, different ways you want to look at it. But I've come up with this way, called the 6 keys. And the 6 keys, 6 key questions that we need to ask ourselves about career. 6 important questions that we need to always check about ourselves. Now, we said earlier, when I started out to say, oh, there are people who are already in the workplace in this room. But the reality is, many of us in this room are also at different stages of our career. Some are in the early days. Some are at this session with the plan of, hey, what's the last major move I need to make before I retire? But the reality is, these 6 keys are important at every step. Are you just starting out? Are you in already? Are you at the twilight? Whatever point you are, it's important. Let's look at the first one. It says, who am I? So someone had said earlier, understand your skills and your strengths. What are the challenges that you face? What are your developmental needs? What are your interests? They define a lot what your career will be ultimately. Okocha would never have made it in basketball. Don't say because of his height. It's likely because of his interest. He grew up playing. You've seen the pick advert of Kanu. That guy grew up playing football with stone. So you need to explain to him why he will not play well in cold, hot weather. But they're kicking the stone on the street. Interest. What's your interest? What's your area? All this affects us for career. Because you may be in a job you don't like right now. You may be sitting in a company you don't really appreciate right now. It's all components of your career and what you need to look at. Your preferences. Who are you? At the bottom of that page, you talked about your personal board of directors. Talk a little more about that. Many of us in this room, if you ask yourself who are you, you may actually be getting a distorted message of yourself. Because it's difficult for any one of us to admit that we are not the best thing that happened. I mean, nobody can run me down. I can't accept that. Would you accept anybody to run you down? Well, it's good for us to hear once in a while. Don't be people that will say the good things or the bad things. But some deeper questions to ask. So naturally, when we say, who am I? I believe that this page is probably a page in your question. But let's ask this deeper question. Let's look at this deeper question. What do you enjoy most about your work? I had a chat with someone, I think it was 2 years ago. Her dad was former president of ICANN. So I say that statement because you understand that she went into accounting by force. She was in 200 level when she was already chartered. But she does not like it. Sadly. She doesn't like it. So, I mean, you know, she was talking about this by pulling me out to the back of the room. She said, I need to talk to you alone. I don't know what to do with my life. So I said, well, what are you doing now? She's in an accounting role. Of course, you need to pay your bills. What do you enjoy most at your work? And she said to me, what I love most at my job is when I leave my accounting job and I sit with the customer service people to attend to customers. It's sad. What do you enjoy most? You need to pinpoint it now. So if we sit down and say, this is a problem, what are your strengths? She will list from now till tomorrow. She's got those strengths. But what does she enjoy most in her current role? What she enjoys most in her current role may be that time she's able to help the MD to think straight. Just that time. That she's able, it's not necessarily the title you carry.
It's not necessarily what your daily bread is, what you enjoy most of your work. It helps a lot. It helps determine what you would excel at, what you want. So you can decide to continue to collect 30 million naira per day that you are earning. But you can decide to continue to collect that arm robber salary. For some people say arm robber is more, a bullion band salary. Huh? You can decide to, and this bullion band is legit, and you can decide to continue to collect it. But determine what you enjoy most. What is it that makes me perform at my peak? What is it that I want to see at work every day? What do you like to do more or less in your current job? Very related, right? What's your personal work life priorities? A lot of us are living the life of people we see in home video. And we forget that it's only in home video. I mean, it's in Hollywood that at 12 midnight she's on the bed, her headgear is still on. I've tried at home to wear suits to bed, 20 dollars more. But you see the man in full regalia, Atiku, and he's on the bed. And the wife wake him up to say, let's talk. How do you do it? But yet, many of us want to live like the professionals we see in the movies. What are your real priorities? What do you want to see? Some of us are so, so family oriented, but so that we could not appear as weaklings. Try to backtrack on that. We don't even discuss it. We don't even talk to our bosses like, hey, I'm going to run late because I need to take care of my family. Because we don't want to appear as weaklings. It doesn't necessarily mean that you need to do all that talk, but you need to let people understand, and you yourself need to admit to yourself, this is my priority, this is important to me. This number four question is so, 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 so real. What do people say about you when you're not in the room? You know what? Irrespective of what they say, you need to go. Good, bad, positive, negative, maybe, trusting, non-trusting, you need to know. Hear no evil, see no evil doesn't work in this case. You need to hear the evil so that you can tackle the evil and shame the evil. You need to know, what are people saying about you? Can you truly talk or say and go forward and say, hey, this is what this man thinks about me. This is what my subordinate thinks about me. This is what my colleague thinks about me. This is what this man would say when I'm in the room or I'm not in the room. How often do you seek feedback on your performance? For many of us, it's at appraisal period. And meanwhile, some of us are already above appraisal. Being approved appraiser does not mean that you are CEO. You know, there are some of us that our managers appraise us based on what we think of ourselves. So that they don't annoy us. You are ready to become the team god. The man knows. Don't be deceived. The man knows that you are that strong. If I tell him that he's bad, he will shake this whole place and he just needs to keep you. Because he needs to keep the business going. And some of us are that strong, that are that important in the business. But the point is, you are only going to stay in that role. Hello? Does that resonate somewhere?
Yes,
there are people that, even as managers, there are some of our subordinates that we just, oh, okay, yes, yeah, you did a very good job. Yeah, I want you to please. You are saying what you want to hear because you know that if this guy leaves now, there will be some shake. And you don't want your boss to complain. So you will keep him. You don't want the system to shake, but the guy will continually be in that role. And this is the man who is saying, I want to grow, I want to be excellent. Which is very, very important for us. What kind of feedback do we get? Where do we get this feedback from? Is it only from our managers? How many of us have sat down with our subordinates to ask them what they think about us? And you know, it's not so easy to talk to your persons below you to say, what do you think about that? You think you get honest feedback? How do they react? Some of the things about how do you find out how people think about you, tell me your subordinates is, when you are not around, what do they do in your absence? What are the things that they keep for you and make sure that you are the one that sends to you before they do it? What are the things that they make sure that, oh, not until I get your signature or your sign up, I'm not doing this. It tells you a lot about what they think about you. It tells you a lot about how much or how well they trust you. Your BOD. Every one of us should have a personal board of directors. Every one of us. And these people should be, one, people that you can be honest with. It's not easy. Some of us cannot even be honest with our spouses. I know. We can't truly, yes, I can say a lot of food game in the house. I know. Some of us can't be honest with our pastors. because you're not sure what your pastor would think of you. Your pastor finds out that you are doing this. But there are some people that, irrespective of whatever happens, you can be honest with them. You know that you can trust them. People that will be honest with you, you need those people that can give you those jabs, and they will give in such a way without making you feel like you're the terrible thing. Right? Hello?
Hi.
Are we together? Hello? So we need those people that can also tell us, that can give us that spiritual spirit. People that can help support you, so they are not only telling you how well or how bad you are doing, but they can also give input into what you're doing. We need people, we need our friends. You need your manager, you need your peers, you need formal and informal mentors. You know, I put a space blank here, and I typically would put sponsor there. But I leave that space always as, there are people that you probably don't have even a perfect definition for. But they give you some sort of input into who you are. Let me ask a question. I mean, is there anybody here who feels that he or she gets some valuable input from, you've gotten some valuable input into who you are from your driver or your nanny? Your driver. I tell my wife, my driver spends more time with you than I. I'm probably married to him. Look at Lagos traffic. We spend 2.5 hours to the island, 2.5 hours back. When I get home, I spend 1 hour with my wife. After 1 hour, I'm becoming irritated. I am listening. And he says, you are not listening. I'm sorry. But I'm with my driver always. I can get input from my driver. What I said earlier about what I'm left. So I typically will sit in front in the car with my driver. If you get to my car, I will tell you, you can't sit there. And I'll gas it down. People say, I say, no, you see, that's the seat. You can't sit there. He tells you, he can define you. He knows that more. Your driver, your nanny. That's why I put that place back. And I tell people, so someone came to me yesterday and talked about mentorship. And many of us talk about mentorship. And I said, there's the biggest problem I have with mentorship is most times when people come to you to say, please mentor me, they forget one key element of mentorship. You know the biggest part of mentorship? Mentorship is feedback. So you say, ID, please mentor me. He says, oh yes. And then you come to ID. Sir, I went for an interview today. ID's job is interview coaching, right? That's not mentorship. When you were applying for the job, when you were making a decision as to this is the kind of organization you are going to work, why didn't you involve ID then? That is, it's able to feedback, it's able to advise. Now we are at the crossroad of interview. Now you are going to have interview with Mary. Say, ID, you know, sir, I'm going to interview with Heritage Bank. You now begin to stutter. You begin to stammer because all you want ID to do is to pick the phone and say, dear Kunle, allowing. When ID should have been involved at the very early stage, so you're making a decision as to this is where, this is what we should be doing. So it's important, it's one of the ideas. It's not only about setting up. And you know, the thing about this is, you're not going to do a boardroom conference, but you need to constantly check with them. How often do you also use them? Some of us have them already, not fully set. But my advice is, ensure that you have at least one person in this room. So you are CEO right now, there are people that are mentoring you. You are your girl or your girl, but there's someone somewhere, who's your manager? Ex-manager, current manager, someone you dealt with before, someone that you truly believe is gone this path. You're an entrepreneur, there are people that have done that business before. Locally, internationally, identify them, let them also connect you. Where am I? Let us ask ourselves, what are we known for in the company we work today? I tell my colleagues, the biggest thing you can get from your colleagues is for them to respect you for reliability. When you are reliable, you know the first thing you get? Trust. When you are reliable. So, as we speak, there's that colleague of yours that you know that by 7 a.m. she's at work. You know, am I right? Hello? Yeah. There's that colleague of yours that if you send an email now, will respond within the hour. Is there someone like that? Do you have anyone like that in the organization? You guys must be working in heaven, you don't have. Or maybe in hell. There's that person that you know within the hour will respond. The response may not necessarily be an esoteric one. It may not even be a solution. But this person is reliable enough to always respond at a time and point when he or she should. Reliability. When you become reliable, you get what? You get trust. When you have maintained and consistently been someone that can be trusted, you know what makes you? You earn respect. You don't get it, you earn respect. So when people talk to you in a particular way, it's because of what you've been reliable about, what they've seen you do, what they respect you for. And you need to address it that way. Where are you in the organization? What are you known for? Are you known as just the CEO? Just because of your title. Are you known as just the purchasing manager? Are you known for leadership? Are you known as someone who brings solution? Are you known for support? What are you known for? So many of us talk about career excellence, many of us talk about what we can do, the difference we can make, how for some reason someone is stunting our growth and all that. What are you known for? The second point is a question that I always tell people to ask themselves at every point in time. Where have I been? Where am I now? Where would I be if I do nothing? 3 years ago, about 4 or 5 years ago, I said similar line and I spoke and I said, if I, in my current role at the time when I was in that organization, if I did nothing, there was a boy I just hired, the boy will fire me. And it was clear, you know when you hire someone that you think is your clothes, this guy is this good, and he's coming with new knowledge, he's coming with technology, he's also coming cheaper. We sometimes forget. He's cheaper. He can do the job. I trained him. If I didn't do something, if I didn't use the one Odo, Kolobi method, you will fire me. You will want to show me the way out. My boss needs to optimize costs. So what the hell is he keeping me Kunle Olaifa for? My name will not open the vault of the bank. I can only do as much as I can do. But he's got someone who's better, who I have trained. Who's going to add his own experience and my experience and other people's experience? If you do nothing about your career now, where would you be? It's a question for us to ask ourselves. What would happen? Where have you been? When you say where have you been, you know where have you been includes every and anything you've seen. Just like I said, many people hire me for the last job they've done. Where have you been includes where you were even born, where you grew up. Where have you been includes the third class you had in university. Of what value is it? That is different from the man who's sitting next to you at the first class. That's part of where you've been. That's part of what you need to pick up and add to it. This is where I've been. This is what has happened. If I want to become a director in a listed company in Nigeria, I know that I need to have had a master's degree. Where I have been is a BS. Right? Hello?
Hi.
2 years ago, an international bank approached me and started to talk to me about a role. And they came back to me. I mean, I'd met with everybody and they said to me, we can't hire you because the local Nigerian law says that you must have had at least 5 years of social level to join the bank. So the director now spoke and said, please, can you help us find someone just to tick that 5 years because I'm tired. It's part of where I've been. That's the reality. Where have you been? Where, what have you done? What is all these things add up to where we are now? So many of us want to tackle our career issues. Many of us want to become excellent and better at career using what we are doing today. You're looking at your last interaction with Mrs. Akomona and say, hey, the last 1 week with her has been great. And that will determine your career. No. It's in the part of today. What's your personal brand? Is that to how you become excellent? What is coming and what is changing? When we talk about what is coming and what is changing, the very first thing that comes to mind is technology. Hello? Am I right?
Yeah.
So it would be easy for me to begin to give examples of, oh, do you realize that 7 years ago there was no Twitter, about that time no Facebook, and this and that. We always talk about technology and what is coming. But you know the truth is that we miss out two things. One, we miss out on not just that the fact that technology is changing things, but we miss out on the fact that technology only comes based on the thoughts behind it. Have we talked about the fact that in this room today there are more touch screen phones than keyboard phones? Why? Have you bothered to think about it? Why? What led to that? People, let's talk. Let's talk. There are more, if you have a touch screen phone, let me see. Touch screen. So why? What led to touch screen? Why all of a sudden there are more touch screen phones than? So we say there's change in technology. You and I will answer quickly. Change in technology. What led to the change in technology? Did you request it? Many, and that's the point. Many of us are only following technology. We are not leading technology. We should be leading. We should question some things. We should determine what happens there. I met a lady once who imports a whole lot of stuff from China. And she said to me that the new trend where Nigerian ladies always had, I mean, about 5 years ago, every dress in town was a V-neck that would show a cleavage. It was not a local thing. The guys who were selling there were the ones who told the Chinese people, produce only this type. They are the ones that sell. So, I mean, and it was in the church. So you say you're a Christian, you want to wear good clothes, but the good clothes are not available, so you now need to wear that one. All of a sudden, you now need to wear veil. Because we are following technology, we're following what the trend is, we're not calling the trend. You should be calling the trend. Technology, we just sit and say, hey, what's coming? What's it? We think technology. The other thing that we don't check is that though technology and all of these things are external to other people, in personal ones we don't check. Career excellence. You're newly married, you're at work, you're going to have babies. Have you thought about it? Do you realize that is even much more profound than the effect of what email, HRIS, technology will do? It affects you on a daily basis. Have you thought about how you will manage your boss in the period when you're pregnant? Have you thought about how you will manage your boss in the period when you go on maternity leave? Someone is going to stay back and do that your job. And there's a chance that he or she will do it better. Even if he or she doesn't do it better, you know what has happened? Competition has started. So it's going to be before only and after only. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Well, we most likely don't think about what is coming. When we think what is coming, what is changing, everybody thinks of what is coming from outside. What is coming about you? You are becoming a father. You used to get to work at 7 a.m. Now that your son needs to go to school, and yet you want your boss to still respect you the way he respects you for coming at 7. Now you come at 8, sometimes 8:05, 8:15. The day the devil scratches your car, you that you have left to sharp sharp, like 7, you are packed, you are in the office and all that, and you are respected for that. What is the change that is coming? And this change is coming from where? It came from this IGO, you are the one that produced it. Because now you need to plan school. Now you need to plan and monitor driver by 2, that the driver has gone to pick this. And when you are in that meeting, you are sitting with Mr. Abuma, you are still in that meeting, your mind is on, and they pick the kid. And then somebody just done a BBM broadcast, or now one small child was kidnapped. Hey! Your mind flies, bim! This change that is coming, that's the reality. How many times have you seen singles complain about kids? You are the one that, and then you are in the office, in fact, your boss may be single. You are afraid to talk about kids in front of your boss because you know she doesn't have. And if you talk about it, you say she's wicked. She's not wicked. The reality is she doesn't understand what you're talking about. And you have not managed to change well. You've not communicated the change well. Not just to your boss, but to your colleagues. If you have to go out by 2, it's not your boss that will do your job. It's a colleague that will come out. We're talking about even the regular ones. If you've got a kid of 1, 2, 3, do you know how often you need to visit the hospital? You know how many times you need to keep late night? You now come to work next day and be talking like me. I'm clearing your shoes every time. What's wrong with you? This was not how we hired you. You used to be a great guy. You are still great, but there's change and you have not recognized it. There's change and you have not managed all those people you need to manage. Many of us just want to strut through it. What next can come? I've always known Excel. you've always known Excel. Yeah, I know. But it's changing. What next can come? So we look most times, when we talk about changes, about what is coming, we concentrate most times on what is external. We don't think about what is internal. You are thinking of career excellence. The next big boost to your career is international mobility. Ladies and gentlemen, have you thought about what will happen to your spouse? The company says, come and go and spend 1 year in France. 1 year. And then, because you are going to France for 1 year, you sell all your property. Because the last guy that went to France, he did so well that after France, they posted him to Belgium and he's there for 5 years. Your case will not be the same. He will be sent to France and he will be sent back home to come and be deputy MD. And so you are coming back home and then you need to review from the scratch what is coming, what is changing. Are you planning for it? Are you preparing every other person here? Are you preparing other people that are involved in this as well? Your values will change. You used to be happy-go-lucky every Friday night before. You used to be at the club, you're partying with your boys and all that. But now, there is madame. You got the new CEO at home. I see a witness there. There's a new CEO at home. Oh, if you don't report him by 10, God will help you, don't worry. had a colleague once who used to hang every Friday. And then she said, why are you doing that?
No, he said, you know, he couldn't look at her. I said, not be only my wife there. My wife, mama, there. When I go see you now, I say, ah, okay. The chairman is at home. The MD is at home. The boy has to report. It's changing. Are you prepared? Can it be an advantage? The fact that the change is coming. Most times, because we've seen that wave. Typically, when you see a wave, what does this look like? It reminds you of tsunami. But there are people riding this wave. This might be the biggest wave you will ride. This might just be that perfect cliff that's going to take you. Boom. Change is coming. Change is coming. Your company has just been bought over globally. And everybody is screaming. This merger that is coming. You already, I mean, in fact, sometimes when these mergers happen, you're already going online to look at LinkedIn. Hey. Now that First Bank has bought Heritage Bank. Aha.
So Mr. Akomola will go on and look at all the directors. This one should not have qualified as me. This is the competition. People, this person is more qualified. But the reality is, First Bank may realize this is the person that is best for this job. Is she preparing? That's the key thing. Whichever way it goes, is she preparing? Because you know what happens most times with merger and acquisitions? Do you realize what happens most times from the HR point? Many of the directors of the merged companies get bigger jobs in other places. That's most times what happens. So the point is, at that point when Heritage is going, you will just surprise that Citibank will think, Mr. Akomola, please come and resume. We've been waiting for this to happen. While she's thinking of the competition, being First Bank, being one individual, she didn't remember that the whole of First Bank is actually the competition, and now she's got a better deal. It could be an opportunity. We shouldn't think about the coming change or the challenges that are possible as only from the point of, oh, this big wave that is coming. We can ride the wave. You're getting married. It could be an opportunity. You know the point, you're getting married, that's GM that has been hiring you. We now back up and like, oh, let's support the young family. He's not super happy that he missed out on the lady, but he has to support me. Yes. She's a very good girl, very decent girl. And all of a sudden, he becomes your sponsor. He now begins to say, yeah, the girl, very... There was no such meeting. Very, very, very trustworthy. The big English starts to come out. Because he missed out on the point of challenging, but she's married now. So it's not only from the point of, oh, this change is coming, I'm not prepared, and it's negative. Let's move on. So we start to look at, where are you going? We were talking a little about this earlier. What's the long, what's the short-term plan? Personal, professional. So many of us plan our home front and our work front separately. We want to have 3 or 4 kids as a woman. I think it's high time you put it into what your career plan would be. It's so easy when we talk about kids and we jump first to women. As a man, it's even much more important. Because one, you need to manage your own career and manage your spouse's career. You don't want to, as a man, and you admit, you don't want to, as a man, to be high-flying, jumping all over the place and you leave your wife at home. When she's got her own career. You don't want to come home every day looking at your spouse and you know that, yes, this woman is not moving because I'm moving. When you can both move together. What's the plan? Where are you going? What do you want to do? What skills do you need to develop to get there? Not just to appear in the office, but even to be a good dad. So sometimes, as little as 20, 30,000 can change the scope of things. We spoke earlier about you dropping off that kid in school. As little as 30,000 naira of it by using a driver can save you that time, if only you plan. It's not because you don't have the money. As little as 20,000 naira can change that plan. If only you inquire from the school, they have a school bus. And they can do the picking and dropping for you. As little as 20,000 naira can help you change the dynamics of that whole, I'm adding a child to my family, if you inquire around the area where you work for a crèche. Sometimes there are even crèches in our block blocks, and we don't know. Because we're just marching through life as it comes. And many a time, particularly in Nigeria, God will help. All of us, God will help us. You know, by the grace of God. It's always by the grace of God. And God is saying, I'm helping you already. Help yourself. God will help us. Praise the Lord. God will help us. You see, there are many pastors in the house. God will help us. What are the goals of the others in your life? This is where many of us miss most times. So many of us are planning, you've sat with your boss, you've exchanged details with your boss, you've confirmed exactly what the career plan of your company is for you. But you have not discussed with your husband. And when a man wakes up and says, no, you cannot go for that training in Mauritius. Yes, ma'am. When he says you can't go for that 1 month extended training in Mauritius, you start to vex. He's not supportive of my career. Men are just wicked. They do this. Is he aware? Did you guys establish the plan together? How did you sell it to him? How did you get his buy-in into it? Before he became this devil, he used to buy into everything. Huh? They are very wicked. Don't mind them, men. Career excellence. We need to look at all of this. Where am I going? How will the fact that others are doing this, how will it affect me? I had a friend who was posted on international mobility from our company last year. You know why she couldn't go? My husband had just got international mobility at the same time to another country. And you know what we realized after we spoke? We were just talking an after hour, but she had the option of delaying her mobility. Now she's missed it. Yes, yeah, but they didn't plan. It was a clear case of, oh, you're doing well, apply for it. Now the man is going to a location that she doesn't even want to go to, and she doesn't have an opportunity. She's stuck here with 3 kids, grumbling and grumbling every day. The man, whenever he calls and is on that Skype, she's putting us up a bold face to make it look like, oh, we are fine, but she's cursing him in her heart. Enjoying himself and I'm here sitting in traffic in Nigeria. Even though there's no traffic, you create traffic. We need to think about what others as well. Those kids, those young ones, you want your kids to attend Green Spring and you live in Moway Bapo. Yes. Yes. Helicopter, exactly. This is time because the decision at that stage that you need to determine that where you would live is determined by where they would school. It's important. Where you would live, now the decision is, okay, I want to make sure that I live within 100 meters or 1 kilometer of wherever my kids are schooling. Many parents today are going through that. So I know people who live in Lekki, they want to live with the big boys, but they still want to enjoy the mainland. Because this is the particular kind of school that my kid needs to go through. This artistic, in 10 years' time, that child might be in Bodina, that child might be in university, might be somewhere else. At that point in time, you need to put into consideration always other people that whatever happens to their career would affect you. Think about it. Not just at home. Have we sometimes bothered to check, how is my boss doing? Hello? How is my boss doing? Do we ever think about that as having huge impact on our careers? Who promotes you? Who would give you your promotion at work? Let's talk about that. Your boss, not the company. It is actually your boss. That wicked man, you got promotion, the man no want it. Believe me, his wickedness supported your promotion. Your boss promotes you. So you need to also think, if my boss is not moving, there's a ceiling. If my boss is not growing, what can I do? If you get that next director job, that man has to become either a super director or be fired. He has to be posted somewhere. If you be considered for that director job, he needs to be away for 1 or 2 days and you would have performed in some sort of acting capacity, that formally or informally. A senior partner with Ernst & Young said this to me about 5 or 6 years ago, and I have never forgotten. You know, I argued with him for 2 weeks. I kept him back, like, it's not true. And he said to me, you cannot be promoted if you can't be replaced. I kept on going back. No. When I understood, oh my God, I started to hire my replacement, started to pour knowledge, started to train them, started to get them ready. You cannot be promoted if you cannot be replaced. Nobody's going to promote you and leave that place as a vacuum. You need to be concerned about the careers of people below you. You want to be posted to be regional manager north. The company doesn't have anybody to manage Lagos. You want to be promoted to the director. That GM knows. The whole company knows. The director is just to wear suit and tie and be in the board and just be the GM that is doing the work. Yet you are going for director training. And you are not preparing someone to take over the GM role. You won't be promoted. You know, it will continue to be a struggle. Everybody goes, so my job every day is to look at the succession plan. Who's the next person who's going to take over from Mrs. Okobome? I mean, okay, he's ready. Ready now, ready later, soon to be ready and all of that. And Mrs. Okobome is not bothering about how our MD will become too big for that role and they can consider her. She's not bothering about how the person below her can be good enough to take over her job. People, we need to think about that. What are the expectations? What do people expect of you? What do you expect of yourself? Many of us are living the dreams of other people. Many of us are living the dreams of the organizations we work with, not necessarily what we want to do with our careers. And you know what the dream or the plan of the organization for you may just be fine. It's not to say it isn't. Most times it is even very, very fine. Both times it can align with what you want to do. But it's key and important that you know what the expectations are. And this probably happens every day. I mean, you go into an appraisal session with your boss and they need to tell you this, that, that, that. Because the expectation or the KPI was not properly established at the beginning. And you come out annoyed. We've all gone through it. I've been through such sessions. Either as a HR manager, as employee or employer. Those sessions, we've all gone through it. But what are the expectations? You know the expectations that kill most of us the most? It's the expectation of the world. Let me ask you a question. Be honest in this answer. And I'm sorry to put you on the spot, man. What kind of car do you think she's driving? She's executive director, Heritage Bank.
SUV.
SUV now? SUV, eh? So imagine the kind of disappointment that will happen when they get a Toyota Corolla. And what happens? They begin to dig. You see people walking beside the car. See a special Corolla. And people...
Is he
the director? That is what happens. People have expectations of us. People outside, your family, your home, when you go to your village. And that happens every day. They begin to look at Corolla like, Maybe, and people, you know what I mean? What is most likely happening? That's a small car for the weekend. That's a small car for the weekend. And these things affect our careers. Expectations. People just blow things out of proportion for you. You can't control it, but you need to be aware of it. You just decide on this is what must happen. ED, anything, man. You know the kind of people that come to you for those checks. When someone comes in and says, you know, I'm looking for 10 million, I've been able to raise 5. You know, I said I should talk to you because I'm the bank. Because I've been keeping, one of my friends says, because I've been keeping the 5 million waiting for you so that you can come for it. But the guy expects that, head of HR, Samsung, West Africa. And Samsung is the world leading IT company. Samsung is the world leading smartphone company. At least now, It is about which bank he's going to pick it from. That should be the question, it's about which bank. But we got those expectations every day. And that affects our career. People expect that because you've been in the banking industry for 20 years, you should be a director. Nah. It doesn't necessarily even mean that is what you're aiming and wanting to be. It doesn't mean that because you're on that path in that bank or in that area, that is how quickly or how fast it moves. And we need to know. What is the expectation on your performance? You know, sometimes people set you KPIs. I don't know if you do it or happens to you. With the mindset of, let's just put it on paper, it's not going to achieve it. They know what they expect you to achieve, you need to find out. Set your KPIs, set your performance targets, set your ideas of things they expect you to be able to do. Your reputation, we spoke earlier about trust, reliability, and all that. What are you reputed for? This woman is the dragon's lair. She's always got every deal she's gone for. Next deal, she'll kill it. Reputation. Now, that next deal, are all the ingredients in place? Nobody knows. Is it possible that the competition for the next deal is the son of the chairman of the business? Nobody's checked that. But it's gone ahead of you. Clear and present danger. See, look, these are things that we need to always think about, we need to check for ourselves, and these are questions we need to ask ourselves. I said something earlier about people not talking to their spouses, not being informed, not talking to their friends and all that. What sacrifice do you need to make? I always tell people, when you're talking career, when you're thinking about career, I don't know if there's any married couple in this room. What man and God have joined together, let no man put upon that. Well, let me tell you, when you're thinking about your career, take out every other person. Think about it first. Let's put it this way. Dear Kunle Olaifa, for you to become HR director of Samsung globally, this is what needs to happen. Take out everything first. Everything. You were born alone. Even if you're a twin, you're married, you're in love and all that, think of everything first. When you finish that congestion, start to plug in what sacrifices you need to make. Then I think, I'm like, oh, my wife's career also needs to grow. Samsung is a Korean company. To be a HRD of Samsung, I need to move more towards Korea. She works with an American company. For her to grow in her career, she needs to move more towards America. If I think first of her before I think about my career, everything will be wrong from scratch. Independent thoughts about it. You need to be what I call selfish about your career first. Then start to establish the sacrifices. This is what my career will need to get to this. But I can't do this now because of this. Because in all of that, I've only mentioned one person who's got a stake. I haven't spoken about kids. I haven't spoken about family. I haven't spoken about society. I haven't spoken about other interests. I haven't spoken about, you know, there are people that were indebted to that not even family. I'm talking about ID. What would ID think about it? What would be important about it? What about other participants in my career? My siblings and all of that. But if I start off in thinking about my career, first about what ID would think about it, go on. What do you think you will need for the next role? What do you think you will need for that next opportunity, that next great boom? What do you think you need for it? Most times, we think it's a good LinkedIn profile. Yes, some people, when I start to see people updating their profile, that is that they are the coach. When you get a lot, so they updated their profile. Most times, we think it's a good interview. That interview, like, oh, that's not what you need for the next role. What do you need for that next role? You know the easiest way to find out what you need for the next role? Anyone? Who is in that role? What do you need for the next role? Let's ask ourselves a question. What do you need to be president of Nigeria? What's the easiest way to find out who is the president? What does he have? What does he have? Does it make sense? No, let's. This is a discussion room. This is not a church. It's a church that I cannot question the pastor. This is not Pastor Kunle. You can question the pastor. You can be careful. This is you lay out on you, you go down. What do you think you need for that next role? The biggest and easiest way to find out is who is in that role? Who is the incumbent? Who is in that role? Who's doing it? What is he doing right or wrong? Oh, that role does not exist in my organization. Who is in that role in the next organization? What do I need to be HRD for this that? Who is doing similar role? What is this person doing well or not doing well? You need to identify. It helps you to know, hey, this is key. This is what I need to look at. This is what I can do better. This is what my challenge will be. Let's move on. So we say, what are the options you can consider when we talk about careers? When you're thinking of that excellence, so it's only natural to think, so straight, I'm a manager, I become senior manager. A manager, I become general manager. Now, this is the one we all would like to see. I mean, really, the reality is nobody wants to go down. In fact, I'm not supposed to be in these rooms, stand in front and tell you to go down.
It's wrong. This is not why ID brought us together. Yeah? How can the Pastor Kunle come and tell us to go down? But there are times in life that we really need to consider that as a career option. I have a friend who says you need to go down so that you can jump up. No. When you want to get the best jump, you need to go down so that you can spring. There are times you need to consider that as a career option. There are times that you need that to get the perfect thing for your career. Lateral. So there are days that you need to think about, hey, I've been in my role for 5 years, it looks like I'm never going to move in this company, I need to move into another company in the same role. But of course, at the time when you're doing that, it's good for you to ask yourself the question, why have you never moved to the company? Maybe because the company is more mature, and the best you can be is what you've been already. Maybe because it does happen, right? Yeah, you're in the company and the MD, the deputy MD, the GM, his family, name. I mean, if you don't be there with Joe, you cannot be in that role. You're doing a great job. You don't have a choice. It's just lateral. You may be in a company, multinational, and the best you can be is that role because that's the extent of that business in Nigeria. Right? So it's sometimes, I mean, the fact that you need to do a lateral move does not necessarily mean it's because you're not doing well. But it's important that you ask yourself the question. And you consider it as an option for your career because it's important for you. Enrich. So you need to look at, hey, I'm in my role now, I'm in this organization now. Part of ways to enrich yourself is more responsibilities, more opportunities even in that role. What are the things that you need to do to get your function and your role to become bigger? Most times this comes from the company. But if your company is not enriching your role, what do you need to do to enrich yourself? So your company may enrich your role by having more responsibilities. Your company may enrich your role by even becoming growing bigger. I'll tell you, the EDs of MTN today were not the same 10 years ago. Right? In capacity, in scope, in everything. Am I right? But director is director. They may not even be earning as much as we're earning then when nobody was really scrutinizing and all that. You may be getting away with a lot of things about them. But those are things. So your role may become enriched most of the time. But if your company is not enriching your role, what do you do? You enrich it yourself by doing what? Let's talk about that. What are the things that you think you can do to enrich your role, to enrich your career? Courses, you go for courses, yes.
You can also look at areas that have posed challenges for the company. Sometimes not necessarily in just your own area. It could be a challenge to the company as a whole that hasn't really been addressed.
Okay. So that's a fantastic one. So it's about also taking responsibility and picking up areas that has not been addressed. You've seen that, hey, you work with Airtel and Airtel rolled out 10 different things. We have only 4. Can you pick on one and add? Within your scope, within your area, train yourself, develop yourself, take on new challenges, own that process of getting things better. Explore. To enrich your career, explore. To get better, to consider as option, explore. Look at opportunities. You are working in a multinational company. How many times have you bothered to look at your company's career portal and look for roles beyond Africa? Look for roles beyond Nigeria. It's a possible. Don't rule it out. Oh, I'm not working in a multinational company. The skills and skill sets that you have today, that companies that are sitting just down the road in Ghana require that kind of skill set. And these days we found out that it's easier to get into Ghana than to Abuja.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because there is typically no presidential jet flying that will keep you in the air for 2 hours. If you've been in those planes, you will praise God. Right? When you are in the air and you can see Abuja and someone says, hang on there. And you are thinking in your mind, MH370. Oh my God. You will not remember all your sins and start to confess. I was on the flight today. I was talking on such a similar flight with the senator from Osun State. And this man spoke pure Yoruba in prayer. Olu wa baba o. It was a crazy experience. The senator from Osun State, you know the thick Osun accent. Olu wa baba baba. That would happen. Immediately we finally landed, we couldn't find him. I didn't see my check-in, check-out and all that. Because when you see that, you know there's no service.
it was a very bumpy flight. And then we were in the air. 2 hours. But that's reality. So you think, oh, the next and only opportunity. Think about. Let's give an example of this. The banks in Nigeria that have grown to be Pan-African. The MD of one of these banks in Ghana, his name is a GMA. MD na MD. You need to push yourself for those things. Some of those banks, the owners and the MDs here did not think they could grow beyond Nigeria. How many times have you challenged your boss? This is our cashew nut business. We can even take it to Ghana. And you won't even say I can be the region. And you will not say, you can take it. Tell me. You read the future and you say, so let's go. So explore, look at opportunities, look at things, and this today there's loads and loads of information. There's opportunities like this where ID brings all of us together to say, let's talk, let's look at what is happening, let's look at what things we can do. It is not only exploring by looking up geographically, exploring by looking at other options. What you're doing today, the business you're doing today, the process you're running today, you don't necessarily have to run into the physical stuff. Can you go online? You don't necessarily need to be the one doing the distribution. You don't necessarily need not to run all the supply chain. Can someone else take it up so that you can do something else? Can someone else take up the running of delivering of that service or that product so that you can continue to develop yourself? And you'll be shocked how your business will multiply in fold right in front of you. Out. Another bad one. Yeah. Pastor Kunle should not be talking about how you get out of that career, how you need to step out of that job so that you can grow. Many of us, as I said earlier, job security. Many of us think of job security from the point of so that I don't get sacked. Many of us are too scared of leaving that role that we're sitting in currently. And meanwhile, the only way for you to actually get up is to get out. You know that a kite is not a kite until it's out. Right? Yeah. You want to be a kite, you want to stand out, you want to close on, and then you're sitting in the house. The kite is just there. The fan will cut it off. When it sees air, when you see all those helium balls, see what happens to them. They keep going and everybody comes and looks at them. You don't have the choice but to look like, oh, what's that that's going? But you're sitting in this room, nobody's gonna bother. So sometimes you need to step out, you need to take a look at your career, like, hey, looking at all the things we've spoken about, the 60s, right? Who am I? What am I doing now? Where do I want to go to? What do I want to get to? I mean, I want to be a global player, and you continue to work locally. You are a global player. I'm serious. But being a global player does not necessarily mean you need to go to the US. Right? Which is why we all need to look at all these options. These are options for each and every one of us to consider. In terms of becoming excellent, do I need to focus strictly on wrapping up? So I'm in the early stages of my career, the next opportunity is this, and this is the way I'm going to go about it and all that. Do I want to explore? Do I want to enrich myself in that role? Do I want to challenge myself in YouTube or by telling my manager, let me help with this? Let me add this as a little bit of what I can do. Do I want to step out completely? Because I want to get ahead in my career, I want to be excellent at what I want to do because I know that this is the area I want to go to. So your career is a journey, not a destination. Most times, the big issue we have with careers is that people want to run the race of others. And the way companies are designed is that there's a path that the company wants to follow, not your career path. Yes. Don't come at me and tell me how like my career. No, I hired you to do a job, not to do your career. You have to do a job, you hired for that role. That's why it's called a job description. There's nothing like career description. I don't have a plan for your career, I have a plan for the job. When I'm told to go find a director for sales, his job is to direct sales. If he does well, then I can consider him for directing other things. My primary job is to direct sales. And many of us actually follow the path of others. We've seen people that have done so well in this path. So there are people sitting in the room who are waiting to listen to this appointment. Listen to everyone she's born, and that's the path they want to follow. They forgot that she's Mrs. Akobone, not Mrs. Everybody. Key. Very important. So we need to look
What is our path? You can be the only one to write your own path. You can become so. I tell people, I think what you call modeling over mentorship. Do you know the difference? Mentorship and modeling. Okay, let me, this is my outside. So most times when we say mentor, it's typically drop down relationship. Modeling is broadcasting. So as we sit here, many of us actually do have models. And these are people that you may be in close contact with, you may not be in close contact, you may be talking to once in a while, you may talk to them often or not, but you're picking one, two things off them. You're learning a lot of things from them. You're trying to. So why is it that we say we want to model our lives after Jesus and not say we want Jesus to mentor us? Because the reality is everything that Jesus does, in the time when you need it, we can't do it. So modeling, try and decide and set your mind to it now. I just want to achieve what my MD has achieved. Why not achieve what every good MD out there has achieved? Why not pick the one, two things you can pick from your MD? Because the MD you're looking at, you see him only in the office. But at home, he's a beast. It's true. You've been there.
I got a weakness in the house.
Why not achieve? Why not? So you want to be like your MD. He's only been able to achieve that MD status by being a ruthless man at home. Is that where you want to be? Are your values the same? Are your preferences the same? Are your priorities the same? All of these adds up. And that's why I need to know that to look at, okay, I'm saying, I'm going to pay for calling you all day. And I see as the perfect person for my career. But I need to take a quick peek and look at how is she doing at home? How is she managing her home front? Oh, she will not be the best person that I know. I want people to teach some ideas as well. Which is why I say, let's model as against strict mentorship. So yes, you should have mentors, but you should look at people that you can pick things from. We talked about nanny and driver earlier. Many of us, I did a random survey 2 years ago in my workplace, and we found out that most of us, our drivers had houses that we didn't have. All of us want to live in Magodo, packed here. And my driver has 3 houses in Akute, not paying rent. And when it's time for rent, I begin to hate my landlord like I didn't use the house. Come on, it's all weekend. Because why do you start hating the man at that point? Yes, you've been using the house. So there's no. Have you ever heard anybody say my landlord is the best thing? No, landlord is. It's okay. It's okay, man. It doesn't disturb me because you expect him to disturb you. So key takeaways. I'm running off. We started off with who am I? We need to conduct a realistic self-assessment. A very, very in-depth, realistic one. By yourself, by your board of directors. Remember what you said earlier about what do people say about you when you step out? When I drop this mic, I expect people to say, oh, great job. When they see me tomorrow, what would they say? Yeah, just kidding. Just yank, and tell just and what do they say about you? The key thing is you should know it's not to control what they say. Most of our leaders make those mistakes, right? By gagging you, by telling you don't talk. Let us. You should even know first what is being said about you before you start the whole correction process. Is it right? Is it wrong or not? Perceptions are real. If people feel that way about you, there's some element of truth to it. Initiate feedback. Don't wait to be told. Most times when you're told, the damage is done. Initiate the feedback process. If you feel your boss is not a nice guy, instead of a meeting with him on Monday, just need to have a chat with you. Do not put him under the pressure of he must like you or no. Just let him tell you his mind, what he feels. Most times when we wait for the feedback, the deal is done. The damage is so far gone that we can't really do anything about it. Have an actionable development plan. Set out something as these are the things I want to do. I mean, looking at what we've walked through today, and I bet that there's so much that we've learned as well. This is where I am now. This is where I want to be. What's the development plan? I say it's about plan. In financial terms, what is a plan? Hello? Is there any finance person in the house? Accountant or whatever? I expect that people will not answer anymore now. When you have questions, they deny their status. So I know that a plan is most times equated to a budget, right? A budget is a what? and a financial plan. Now, when you set out a budget, when you prepare a budget, what is the likely outcome of the budget? Hello, guys, please, don't bother me. I've got two or three more minutes. Let's talk about it. It's very important you get putting together a plan. Many of us make mistakes when we put together plans. That's what I'm about to talk about. When you put together a budget, when you budgeted time, money, or whatever, what is the most likely outcome of that plan, that budget? There's variance. What? So the variance will either be this or that. What happens? I'm just looking for some particular one. So a budget will either end up as surplus or right? We're in agreement. Nigeria's budget is in don't say. Let's move on. So we say a budget is either in surplus or
GDP.
We rebase our GDP. Very good. Okay, so we say a budget will either end up being a surplus or a deficit. When a budget is in surplus, what do you do? When it's in deficit, what do you do? The question is, when a plan is in surplus, what do you do? We most times set out to do plans. We don't think about the outcome and we don't think about what we need to do when we set out those plans. This is what frustrates many of us. So I planned to be here by 9 a.m. today, but I got here 8:55. I mean, what?
Surplus.
What did I do with the remaining 5 minutes?
I was able
to settle in. Was my plan to settle in? No. That's where the problem comes from. So many of us set our plan. You've developed your action plan now. You've had a fantastic time with ID, Kunle, Mary, Richard, and everything is going on well and all that. You develop the plan, and then 2 months down the line, there's a crash in the plan. What you do when you get a surplus or a deficit that you replan? Many of us only plan once, and that's why I'm saying let's take some time to listen to that very well. You develop an actionable plan. You plan that, hey, for the next 2 years I'll be in this role. All of a sudden the company is going down. All of a sudden 6 months time you will be promoted for the role that you wanted 6 months ago. Many people get stuck on that promotion and don't get the next one because they didn't plan. What next? Your plan was, hey, by age 25 I'll be married, and at 23 you fell in love. In fact, 25 you're already after one. What next? You do another one.
Yes.
Plan, and so then your budget cannot end up the same. Don't be deceived. Let's have that at the back of my mind. We're not kids, so let's think about it. I'm making a plan now for my career, but there will be changes. There will be changes because of external and internal factors. All I need to be mindful of is when I've got a plan A, there's a B, there's a C, there's chances and all that. We plan every other thing well. We plan our careers to the letter. By age 30, I'll be manager. 32, I'll be senior manager. Like, see, now you get the company. Now you go appraise yourself. Now you go sell the goods. And so, it's key. That's why it's important. It's a budget. It's a plan. You've set it out to, hey, it's going to hit this target, and for some reason the goalpost changes. How many of us have KPIs, and all of a sudden when it's time to do appraisal, your boss says, no. And all of a sudden, the no is just getting my eyes. But we agree, no. And you're thinking, it's a change. The target has changed. I'm sure Mr. Apobeme deals with all those shareholders every day who are expecting them to double the bank just like that, like Nigeria is doubling. And I'm thinking, the economy is not doubling, and you put pressure on directors to say double. How can you have grown only 60%? And you know when they stand up to talk at those AGMs, their brother is very big. How can you have grown only 60%? The question is, sir, did you grow your own personal business 60%? Even 6% they didn't get. Mobility helps. Yes, I want to talk a little about mobility. Mobility helps, especially with the new age we're in. I said earlier, mobility is a key part of what you need to look at. And mobility is not necessarily you uprooting your life and moving. But think about all the options. Think about what happens. Do not be stuck in a place. Mobility is not only in terms of geographical location. Have a mindset of, hey, I can move. I'm flexible enough. I'm adaptable. I can make things happen in different ways. Mobility does help careers. Own it. And the last note I would say, no one cares as much about your career and your development than you do. Take charge, don't you? Thank you very much.